The transactional process that leads to the emergence of space-time events occurs only through the electromagnetic field. The other forces are certainly in play at a fundamental level. They govern the unitary interactions, the kinds of scattering, you know, interactions and so on. Now, the weak decay, you know, the weak forces involved in decays. And of course, the Schrodinger's cat, you can illustrate that with just a decay in terms of an excited atom emitting a photon if you want, right? So it doesn't have to be, it doesn't have to be the weak force. But the weak force is certainly really in there in terms of these unitary interactions that transform, that kind of govern these kinds of transformations among types of particles and so on. And that's very much part of the transactional picture. So in other words, the transactional formulation very much accommodates all those fields. The thing that it treats distinctly is the electromagnetic field, because that's a massless gauge field. So you require a massless gauge field to get you the emergence of space-time. So these other ones have mass, and so they are unstable in a sense, and they act only really kind of locally at the quantum, at the level of possibilities. And not locally, but they act at the level of possibility, if you will. So these are force-based interactions, the strong and the weak force that are going on, metaphorically speaking, in the submerged portion of the iceberg. But they're very, you know, TI doesn't deny any of that. It's very much part of the same physics.
Another massless gauge field is gravity, or at least under some interpretations of quantum gravity, you have the graviton. So does TI make any claims about that?
So we deny that gravity is a quantum field. So what we get, you know, we basically say the mistake in, you know, what's so problematic about trying to reconcile the quantum level with the relativistic level is trying to characterize gravity as a quantum field. So gravity, we say, is not a quantum field. It's the field is the metrical structure of the emergent space-time, end of story. And that's what Einstein said. I mean, you know, he said that that's what the field is. It's the metrical structure of space-time. So it's a property of those sets of events. And so, I mean, people who want, you know, who want the detailed story of that, they want to see the, you know, see the actual math, see the actual theory. We do have an actual theory that derives the Einstein equations from that picture.
So then, is the transactional formulation a theory of everything, a contender for a toe?
Well, you know, I guess I never like to claim that. I guess you could say that it's a theory of the quantum level and the space-time relativistic level. I guess I'm not clear in myself that physics can explain, you know, everything about reality, including people's thoughts, motivations, and intentionalities, consciousness. And so from that standpoint, I would never, you know, I would be a little more modest about the reach of physics. But within topics that are considered physical questions, yeah, I mean, you could say that, because it's definitely providing an account of the interaction of the quantum level with the space-time level, with the, you know, the relativistic level, and, you know, it's quite straightforward.
Yes, well, in physics, the term theory of everything is just for a framework that encompasses both gravity and the standard model.
Sure, well... Yeah, I mean, the transactional formalism, again, is simply contained in applying the direct action theory of fields to the kinds of physics we're already working with, and admitting that saying fields propagate unilaterally and retarded fields only is wrong, replacing that with the direct action theory for the electromagnetic field. That's all it is. And we're just showing how fruitful that is, what you get out of it. So, I mean, the transactional formulation does not purport to explain the origins of quantum chromodynamics or anything like that. But where appropriate, the claim is that nature is behaving according to the direct action theory of fields. And let's see what that gets us. And we are already showing, you know, how much we get from that.
In many physical theories, in virtually all physical theories, there are parts that don't change, and then there are contingent parts. So for instance, the force equals mass times acceleration for Newtonian mechanics, it doesn't change, but initial conditions are contingent. So what are the parts of your theory that are contingent, and what are more constitutive?
Well, I mean, it's really the same, you know. I mean, it's still the case, and you know, the only thing different about this theory is the way that the fields operate, the way that the electromagnetic field behaves. So we're still going to have, you know, Newton's laws as a suitable non-relativistic approximation. We're still going to put in initial conditions, you know, and in a sense, yeah, so then none of that's really going to change. But I think overall in the big picture, it's a more satisfying account because, you know, you help yourself to initial conditions that, at least for a quantum situation in the conventional theory, are just stipulated. You know, like you can't say why you got a measurement result. You know, so in the transactional formulation, you can at least say, well, there was a measurement interaction and I can explain why that happened. And then there was perhaps a collapse to a result, but I can say why there was an outcome available to me. So, yeah, I mean, fundamentally, it's not going to change those kinds of features of theories.
Does it have anything to say about Bell's inequalities or the Koch-Specker theorem?
Well, those are basic theorems that point to the non-locality of quantum theory. And that is certainly still the case in the transactional formulation. I mean, unlike some interpretations, the transactional formulation does not, at least as I've elaborated it, it's not trying to preserve locality. This, I think, is very much, you know, trying to cling to some metaphysical ground rules that are not really serving us well. The quantum world is non-local in a sense that's what the violations of Bell's inequality and so on are showing us, you know, maybe that's uncomfortable. But once again, if you allow the idea that nature does have this level of possibility, then it makes sense that you're going to be observing things that look non-local to you, that there are interactions that can go on that seem to defy your expectation that everything's happening in a space-time container. So that, you know, I would say that's very much, those are authentic implications of the formalism of quantum theory in the sense that there are non-local influences going on.
Okay, so two quick questions about that before Koch and Specker. So you said it looks non-local to you. So does that mean that underneath the iceberg, there's some version of locality, maybe it's not called locality, that is preserved, and then when it gets emergent upward or in the geode picture, it looks like it's violating locality?
Well, I mean, in the usual sense, in the sense that there are influences that seem to propagate at speeds that are, you know, seem to exceed the speed of light. They are technically non-local, but where we can gain some insight into those influences not being something that we should forbid, you know, it's helpful to look at the flatland metaphor, you know, the flatland Edwin Abbott story where there are flat shapes in a plane and they think that's the entire reality. But if it isn't, you know, then you can have these, you know, the sphere hovering and coming and doing these weird things that, from the standpoint of the flatland creatures, look non-local and crazy and know this can't be happening according to the rules of my world, which tells me I can only stay on this plane and only can do this, right? But those rules don't apply to an entity that has more degrees of freedom and more higher space to work with. And that's the sense in which I think these non-local interactions are occurring. Strictly speaking, by the rules of getting from here to there on flatland, they're violating that. But it doesn't mean that they can't really be happening and that we shouldn't, you know, it means that, okay, there's just a larger aspect to reality in which more kinds of influences are possible. And again, these do not violate relativity because the influences that are happening are not sending light signals. You know, so it's conforming to relativity, but it's violating our sense of propriety concerning what we think should happen in flatland. And so what I'm saying is, let's let go of that, you know, that restrictive sense of what's okay and what isn't okay in terms of what's physically happening. So yeah, non-locality from the standpoint of influences being able to be communicated that don't depend on light signals. Yeah, that does happen in the direct action theory, and it's okay. It doesn't, you know, it's not something nature's not allowed to do just because we don't like it.
So is the non-locality just a correlation or is there causation to it?
Well, this depends what you mean by causation. For instance, the scattering, you know, interactions that you referenced earlier, those are brought about in terms of non-local connections among the electrons. So that time symmetric propagator that connects those electrons that are scattering, it's clearly doing something. It's causal in the sense that it's doing something, but it's pre-measurement. It's not something that is connected to a space-time event. It's part of the sort of behind the scenes dynamics that's building up to make certain events more probable than others. So it's definitely doing something physically efficacious, but it still respects relativity in that, you know, it's not something where you're using a light controllable light signal and sending a signal from A to B and so on. It's happening at a subtler level.
You don't violate the no signaling theorem.
That's correct. Not at all.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's get to Kokenspecker. What is your account of it? And also, can you please tell the audience what that theorem is?
Well, the Kokenspecker theorem is basically a theorem that shows that what kinds of phenomena you can come up with are contextual. You know, that you cannot say for all observables I can assign a yes or no answer. You know, for all cases. And this has to do with the fact, you know, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle and the fact that observables don't commute. So it's a consequence of that, the non-commutativity of these observables, that only, you know, that for two observables that don't commute, like position and momentum at the non-relativistic level, you can't just say, you know, I can assign a determinate momentum property for the system for all, you know, cases and also a determinate position, you know, that it's really this position and not all of these others. So you can't just have a space where you clearly lay out determinate yes or no whether this system has, you know, this momentum and that position. You can't make a collection of these outcomes for mutually incompatible observables in this way. And this is perfectly fine. This is a feature that one would expect at the level of possibility. Because again, you know, possibilities are not determinate outcomes. And while you have it's a feature of these possibilities that when a system can be said to, you know, has been, say, set up or prepared in some determinate state of momentum, it really does not have a determinate position. And this is simply because at the, you know, in the transactional approach, we would say, well, it hasn't transacted.
I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism
means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in. And now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.